let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this time that we can meet together as a church, the body, Lord. We know that you are the head of the church, Lord, and Lord, help us to stay connected to you, Lord, as we listen and we seek what our church is to be about, what we're supposed to be doing. Lord, always help us to stay connected to you and to your will for Westside Baptist Church. Lord, I just thank you for those who are here this morning, for those who will be watching online. Lord, I just pray that you will bless them for taking the time to be here. Lord, we continue to pray for your protection, our community, and our church. Lord, and we just turn over the service to you this morning. Lord, it is your time, and we just give it to you. May your Holy Spirit have free reign to come down this morning to mess up our plans, to mess up our schedules and our lives, so that we'll follow you, Lord, more closely than we have in the past. Lord, we thank you for those who are here, and we ask all these things in the precious, powerful name of Jesus. All God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
Every heart that
Jesus died on the cross for us and saved us, and because of that, we have a living hope right now. Despite the craziness going on in the world, we have a living hope. The song is called Living Hope.
Yeah. ourselves to you this morning, Lord God. We want to praise you, give you all glory for who you are, God.
Amen.
You're the God of the universe, the one true God, our holy heavenly Father. Jesus, we want to give you praise for being our Lord, being our Savior.
Amen.
Stepping out of heaven, down to this place we call earth, Lord. That you might buy us back. You might redeem us.
Amen.
You might be the sacrifice once for all. Righteous for the unrighteous, Jesus, that you gave your life.
Amen.
Willingly. On the cross. It's a cruel criminal's cross, Lord. Suffered the shame, the mockery, the beating, the flogging, the cruelty of the cross, Lord. For my sin, for our sin, for the sins of the world. And whosoever believes in you should not perish, but have everlasting life. And we just want to simply say thank you for that this morning, Lord.
Yes.
Give you all praise and glory for your right words. Lord, this morning, thank you for this worship service that we can have together, Lord. Thank you for the musicians. Thank you for Rebecca, Zachary, Miss Amy, Miss Vicki, Miss Linda, and Mr. John. Thank you for the congregation. Thank you for allowing us to sing for you, Lord. For our song is for you. It's not for the person behind us, next to us, not for our spouse or children. Lord, our song is for you. May our hearts sing to you this morning. We're going to give you this service, every piece and part. From the very rehearsal before it took place, to the fellowship that's taking place this morning, to the times of prayer, the message of Pastor John, we want to lift it up to you, Lord. We want to give it to you. Lord, we pray that you touch each one that's here today, Lord God, what they need, whether they be a longtime church member or a visitor today. From the very youngest to the very most senior amongst us, Lord. Everyone has needs and desires and things going on in their lives that you can assist us with, Lord God. That you can help us with. Father, touch each one with their need this day. Whether it be what it might be, Lord God. Whether it be a physical ailment, emotional, mental. Most of all, the need of salvation, Lord God. May today be the day of salvation for that one lost soul, whether they're within the walls of this church, or whether they're online watching this morning, or that they might watch later on this week, Lord. Pray that today might be the day of their salvation. We'll give you all the praise and glory for that. Lord, as we continue to move through a virus that seemingly has infected the world, we'll continue to pray for those that are impacted and ill. Healthcare workers, those in leadership at the local level, state level, national level. They might make decisions that are for the best for all of us. Help us as a church as we continue to move forward. Make decisions that are in the best interest of the church, Lord. We simply want to obey you in the midst of it all. Help us minister to our community continually, Lord. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah.
Right, please be seated. Please be seated. And welcome this morning to Westside. Again, whether you're on site or online, we're thankful that you're with us this morning. We appreciate you, your desire to be in the house of God, whether that's virtually or if you're here. We're thankful. I want to share a few announcements with you this morning. The Deacon of the Week is Brother Darren Browning. If you have a need this week, reach out to Darren, whether he can assist you or one of us deacons or something from Pastor John in the office. If you reach out to us, we'll be glad to help you out. Just let us know. Contact one of the week will be Darren. Let's see here. What else we got to share with you this morning? This Sunday night, our worship coming up on August 30th. It'll be at 6 o'clock. We'll get a sign-up sheet out in the foyer on the round table. A few folks that are already signed up, I encourage you to do that. You may not necessarily have seen talent like me. Maybe there's something you want to share, a poem or something that speaks to your heart about Christ. I think Brother John will be all right with that. It is a night of worship, so I don't want it to be just a general poem. I don't think it needs to be something that honors the Lord. So if it's a first set of scripture out of.
Testimony.
Any of those of you who are musically talented, also please sign up. We would love to have you join us. Take part in that. Next Sunday afternoon, 4:45, we'll have a church council meeting. So if you are a leader of a team, please come to that. Any committee leaders, we need you there. Even if you're making a determination that you want to change, we would ask you to come to that. Maybe you've already let John know your desire, but if you'll come to that, we can work together through that for the coming years. So if you don't know, most of you may know, September to the end of August is our church year, and we start out a new leadership and those kind of things. So that's why we have that church council meeting toward the end of August to work those kind of things out. So we'll be here next Sunday at 4:45 in room 101 in the Sunshine Lady classroom. And let's see here, again today was Sunday School Promotion Day, so please promote it up. There are a couple out of our class will move up once they're able to be in attendance again, so just be reminded of that. And then also, last thing, for children's ministry, I know some of you are curious, and we're going to start that back. That will happen after Labor Day. Okay, we may do a couple things before then, as far as some outreach type things. Still waiting for more leaders. Got about five or six that are interested. So what I'd like to do is for about 5 minutes after church today, I want to draw on anybody else's interest. So if you're interested in helping with our children's ministry, it will be a lot. I'll be registering for a lot of this week. We've had that discussion between myself and Pastor John and some other leaders. So we're going to do that. And we'll discuss that and talk more about how all that will work and how we'll do a lot. Yeah, we'll meet for about 5 minutes today after church. So if you can do that, come right up here. I'll be up front. And just find me. It doesn't matter which side. Just look for me and gather, if you will, just briefly. And then we'll go from there. I think I've covered everybody else. Well, Zach, did I miss anything? Do you have anything you want to share? No, good. All right. Well, we're glad you're here this morning. I'll thank you, Zach, and all of us. We are glad you're here today. Let's stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord. You will have time for children's message. If you're here on site, your child, just stay where you are. We're not going to leave you guys here. I'll come up here and share it online. So let's greet one another in the name of the Lord. Thank
place in this space, which is God.
Thanks for everybody.
My phone.
I'm gonna regret that I didn't go up there to do the show, and I'm gonna get a rant on. Dare not cut my sound off. Do you have something I want to continue to share with the kids this morning, as well as, kids at heart? Last week we talked about a five-finger prayer, right? And we talked about the thumb, which is praise, index finger, thanksgiving, middle finger intercession, ring finger, confession, and pinky finger, petition. And so last week we focused on praise, and we read from the 146th Psalm, talking about meditating on God's, the attributes of God, and praising Him for who He is. And today, we want to talk about being thankful. Thanksgiving in our hearts for what God's done in our lives, in the lives of our family, in our individual lives, our church was a church. So that's what I want you to be thinking about here as I share from the scripture. And I want you to think of a person's name that you're thankful for. We're going to play the name game. It's not the normal game game. I'm going to ask for a little audience participation here shortly. I keep copying John. We had everybody come up here last week. So there's a little bit of an audience participation. We're going to have to do it today. But I'm going to ask you for a name. Think of somebody that you might be thankful for today. I've got somebody on your heart that you might not think this person I thought of this morning. For some reason, the Lord brought this person to my mind this morning, and I'll share her name shortly. And I want to read from the 5th chapter of Ephesians, and I'm actually going to step back, focusing on verse 20 to verse 15. So there's some good stuff in these verses here. It says, be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. And this is where I'll focus here shortly. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always, verse 20, always giving thanks to God the Father of everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We know that, I think that comes from spiritual maturity, when we're being thankful for where we're at in our lives. And sometimes you're maybe in one of the lowest places that you might possibly be. Boys and girls, we're all going to experience hard times in our life, bad times in our life. You know? I think about my grandparents, if you will, and some of our senior adults who might have grown up in the era of two world wars. Even a bad plague at that time occurred, and they lived through the Depression and really hard times, the Second World War, Vietnam. You can go on and on and on with things. But I never heard my grandmother and grandfather not be thankful, even through the hard times they went through. So we're all going to go through hard times. We're in a difficult time. It's a difficult age that we're living through, because we don't know the reality of it. Is a lot of us has to do with the uncertainty of so many things, right? You know, it's uncertain for teachers, for students, for parents, and all of us, really. What we're experiencing, who do we trust, who's the expert? Some experts say this, some experts, who's really, it can boggle your mind. It really can. And you guys probably don't pay attention to that at all, but some of us adults like me probably pay too much attention to it. But the reality of it is, in the midst of our time, we can be thankful. And we want to just think of people and think of things God has done in our lives, where He's placed us, what He's doing in the midst of hard times. And that's what I just specifically want to focus on, persons. God brought to my mind Aunt Jeannie. And I'm going to know why this morning. But if you, some of you may remember Gene Ford, he's a member of this church, and he brought to my mind Aunt Jeannie. And I'm thankful for her for many reasons. You guys don't know what this season of year represents to me, as I reminded her. She worked for me. You know, me, they had spiral notebooks and paper. We never had need for those kind of things. But Aunt Jean, because she would take us out there, or she would have it at her, you could go to her basement, and it was literally as much as more than Walmart had. she provided that for all, she didn't have her own kids, but she provided that for her nieces and nephews. Another great example of her on Wednesday night, she's come up to me with that little hand like this right here. So I'm happy, you know, what was hidden inside her hand was a little bit of cash. Well, a little bit of cash, to be honest with you. She got here to take this. Don't tell him. And she would do that quite often. And she would do that and helping us in ministry. And she was faithful to that. And the Lord just brought her to my mind this morning. Boys and girls, my Aunt Jean was a faithful member at this church, served in many capacities, specifically in Sunday school department and senior adult area for years. I just appreciated how much she loved us as nieces and nephews and the things she did for us. She was solid gold in my mind. So anybody else have a name? Audience participation, just one person's name, and just shout it out.
Well, it's my anniversary, so I'm really grateful for my husband today.
There you go. Boy, there you go. Anybody else have a name you want to shout out? Miss Ann.
My husband.
Gotcha. Juan, yes, ma'am.
My husband.
Your husband. Anybody else? Kids, any boys and girls? Darren in the back.
Can I do two people?
You can do two people.
All right. My wife, number one, and my mother, number two.
There you go. Wife and mother.
Can I say one more?
Absolutely.
My mom.
Your mom. Anybody else? Barbara. Any other people thankful for anybody this morning?
Barbara.
Brother Terry.
Barbara.
Barbara. Anybody else? Isaiah, right? Is that right?
Israel.
Sorry. Another biblical name. Israel.
Grandma.
I hear you. Good deal. Grandma. Good stuff. Right? Anybody else? Yeah,
How about you, Bobby?
Wow.
How about you? You set a great example for everyone in this church.
Amen.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it. Okay? No. Thank you. I was not trying to pull that out of the show. I didn't get it. Anybody else? Rebecca, you said that. I'm just kidding. Yes. Your roommates, yeah. I remember being your age, your roommates are good stuff to have, and they never do those problems you go through. Anyone else? Hey, two people right there. Well, hey, she's thankful for well. All right, boys and girls, or adults, you may not share that, but I know you got people in your lives that you're thankful for, appreciate, and some that you didn't think of as a special aunt, a grandmother, Israel, or roommates, or parents, or your spouses, or your mother, husbands, I've heard several husbands, and I think we're just thankful to even be participating this morning. And boys and girls, I would just encourage you, when you think about those loved ones you have in your lives, in your family, thank God for them. Say a prayer for them. If somebody's name comes across your mind during the day, you're like, wow, I thought about that. It was just somewhere God sent us. Say a prayer of thanks for that person. So boys and girls, try your hardest and your best, as the scripture tells us there, to always give thanks to God for everything, not just people, for what you have, for where you live, the home you have, food that's provided to you, your parents, your church, and everything that you have. It is a gift from God. That's right. Father in heaven, Lord, we want to praise your name, Jesus. Your name is above every name. There's no other name that compares to you. Yours is the only name by which you can be saved.
Amen.
Name of all names, Jesus. Lord, we want to praise you for who you are. Praise you for saving us. And thank you for saving our souls, Jesus. Thank you for boys and girls that are here, whether they be of elementary age or of youth age or adults. Us this week in our hearts to spend time in prayer with you, spend time being thankful for the people we have in our lives. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Shabbat just mentioned verse 20, it says, always giving thanks to God and the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Sin was greater, love was greater.
pray that you just help us in our life right now, whatever struggles we're facing, that we can just lay them all at your feet right now, God, that we can just focus on you, and that we can just learn something to help comfort us today, God. Pray that we can lean on each other, that we can praise your name, and that we can just feel peace and comfort and joy today, God, through your name. Amen. So I'm going to praise you. And just say amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, praise team. Father who sees what is done in be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. And then he goes into the Lord's Prayer. If you'll skip just a little bit, go to verse 16 of the same chapter. Jesus teaches on prayer, on fasting here. Look what he says here in verse 16. He says, when you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their full reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head, wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father, who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So I want to point out two different postures that I believe the scriptures talk about this. The first one is a posture of, I kind of call it humility. Maybe there's a better word for it. Maybe it could be like you're not advertising it, secrecy or something like that. Our prayer life, there are times when we need to share, and especially when we pray for each other, we need to share our prayer time, we need to do that. But Jesus is teaching here in these scriptures that it's nothing that we want to make it something that we brag about. And you see the two different examples there. He talks about prayer in verse 6. In this first section, he says, go into your room, close the door. We're not going to advertise that, I'm praying, and blah, 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 and to our own horn, so to speak. But Jesus says, go into your own room and close the door. This is something that I really haven't done much of myself, as far as like going into a room and actually, having a prayer closet up until recently. And sometime last year, I kind of started, in my house we used to live in, we had a big enough closet. It was huge. We missed that closet now because the house we moved to was a little bit smaller, but it's okay. But I missed that big closet, But that was a place that I could go in there, and it was at work, kids were doing whatever. I'd go in there and just get on my knees and pray. And even though it was kind of symbolic, Jesus talking about, go and close your door. It was something that was just, I'd never really done that up until maybe a year or so ago. And I experienced it like, okay, this is powerful. And so for you and I both, that's one posture that we need to look at is maybe you don't have a closet you can go into because there's too many things in it or whatever. But what Jesus is saying there is take some time and find a quiet place. So many times in the scriptures say that Jesus went off to a solitary place, to a quiet place, why? So he could be alone by himself. And that's the key part of this passage here. So that when we go to the Lord in prayer, it's not necessarily always for something we want to publicly announce and for everybody to hear us. And sometimes we have those times. We pray together corporately. But Jesus is saying here for our prayer time, make that your time with the Lord. And then you skip ahead back to the section here about fasting. He says there in verse 17, he says, put oil on your head, wash your face. So, when someone fasts, they're going without food or they're skipping something to take that time and to go to the Lord in prayer about that. Jesus here is saying, don't advertise that. When we started doing, when I printed these prayer guides that are back there on the music folder back there, the Lord impressed on me to do some things, and then I was like, I'll share that with the church, maybe they can do that, we can do that together. And then the Lord just quieted me and said, no, don't share what I've asked you to do with the church yet. Maybe there'll be a time, maybe he'll allow me to do that, but I just felt like the Lord said, no, just let it be your time. I don't want to influence you. If, Brother John, you're doing that, well, I better do that. Then it becomes some kind of a competition thing. Well, he's doing that, so I gotta step up my game, or she's doing this, so I've got to, and maybe that's part of it. But here Jesus is saying, hey, don't advertise. Don't purposely go out of your way to tell people that, look at me, I'm doing this. That's your private time with the Lord. That's really the first posture that I see there. Twice in the scripture, you see this on the outline there, this is the next two points. There's this issue of the unseen versus the seeing there. What am I saying? There's a, it's a play on words here in Scripture, starting in verse, going back to, verse 5 or 16, twice, it says the same thing. It says here, but when you pray, go to your room, close the door, pray to your Heavenly Father who is unseen, then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So there's this kind of play of words about we pray to God who's unseen, but the God who sees everything will reward you. And it's the flip side of that. Twice he says here, those people that pray on the street corners or that go to the temple and pray loudly for everybody to hear them, he said, Jesus says twice, they have their reward. If that's all you're after in your prayer life is trying to impress somebody, if you go into Bible study class and, oh, I'm going to pray today, and my teacher's going to ask me to pray, so I'm going to use this big 25-cent word, and, you know, look at me, that's the wrong reason to pray. Take that attitude and get rid of it. If that's in your mind, if the Lord leads you to pray, and you pray to Him like you're talking to Him like you regularly would, don't puff it up. But you see, there's that seen versus unseen. So that's the first check that we need to look at in our posture of prayer. Are we praying to be heard by people? Are we the first one in our Bible study class to say, ooh, I want to pray, you know? And we maybe don't allow somebody else to grow in their prayer life because we're the ones always volunteering to pray. Maybe the Lord wants to use somebody else to stretch them in a way. So just pray through that and see what the Lord may have you do. Does your posture of humility there need to change it? And then to turn with me to Luke chapter 11, we're going to look at the second posture, which you can see on your outline, is to pray boldly. There are a couple different passages that Jesus talks about our prayer posture being bold in our prayer life, but I chose this one because it's the Luke version of the same passage that we're looking at in Matthew, the Lord's Prayer here. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, give us today our daily bread, forgive us our sins, as we also forgive everyone who sins against us, and lead us not into temptation. Luke 11, verse 5, then Jesus goes to give this example here about an attitude of prayer. He says, so starting in verse 5, he said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and he goes to him at midnight and says, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread because a friend of mine on a journey has come to me and I have nothing to set before him. Then the one inside answers, don't bother me. The door is already locked. My children are in bed with me. I can't get up and give you anything. But listen to verse 8. He says, I tell you, though he will not get up and give him the bread because he's his friend, yet because of the man's boldness, he will get up and give him as much as he needs. So Jesus is teaching here that when we come to the Lord in prayer, we go to God in prayer time, we need to be secretive, not boastful. But secondly, we need to come boldly before Him. And this is what, if you read through the book of James teaches the same thing. James says, if you go to the Lord and you're not expecting anything from the Lord, then you're probably not going to receive something. We need to go in our prayer life to have expectations. All right, Lord, I know you will hear me. Lord, and I know you will answer me. It might not be the way I want, Lord, but I know you're God and you will answer. So we need to have that same attitude in our prayer life, to be bold, to boldly approach the throne. Parable that came to my mind was the parable of the persistent widow. And you remember that from Scripture where, you know, the Bible says that the judge was either a God-fearing man or someone who cared about men. So he didn't care about God or mankind. He was this judge, and he was ruthless. But because of the persistence of this widow, he granted her what she wanted. And so when we go to the Lord in prayer, let's first look at our posture. We need to be humble, but we also need to be bold. So you might think, well, those things are opposite. Not really. We can kind of keep secret. We can keep our prayer life humble. We can not advertise it, but we can also boldly go before the Lord. So check and say, how am I doing on that? Am I going to the Lord? We're like, well, whatever you want, Lord, to happen, maybe, you know. Or we say, Lord, I know that you will answer. I know that you hear me, God, and I'm asking. And so that attitude is key. Second thing on your outline is our preparation. Now, for this, I'm thinking of spiritual warfare. If you got your Bibles, last place I want to ask you to turn is Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. You're probably familiar with, you know, Paul's armor of God and the different pieces that Paul kind of illustrates beautifully there. He's probably chained to a Roman guard, most biblical scholars think, as he's writing this, looking at this Roman centurion or this guard who's got all this armor on and a sword and his feet with boots and a belt and a breastplate. But the most, I believe, the most important thing as part of this armor of God comes right after all these different pieces that he lists. In verse 18, look what he says. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. And then verse 19 would go, Paul even asked for prayer for himself. He says, pray also for me that wherever I may open my mouth, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. We all say, Lord, that's our prayer, that's my prayer. So number two here is our preparation. One thing that we can practically do in our prayer life is to pray through our spiritual warfare. Now, sometimes we're not always aware of the spiritual warfare that's going on. Sometimes we don't think about that. We just get so busy in our day. I gotta get up and do this, feed the dog, and fix breakfast, and wake my child up, and then go, you know, and we just get bogged down with a lot of go, 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 go. But I think the very best thing we can do is start a day in a time of prayer. Actually, go ahead and put the picture up there next. I think, yeah, okay. This is a picture from about 4 or 5 years ago. The students were going to Centrifuge, right? You see, poor Dylan, he was the lone boy of that trip that year. All those other girls, I'm sure he hated them. Okay. But that year, we went to camp. Now, usually, what I would do before we took off, got the bus, and drove to Florida or to the mountains in Tennessee, one of the things I would do was take the bus and go kick the tires a little bit, have an oil check, make sure everything was good. That's probably a better time to check a vehicle out before. Just think, if you're going to drive, you know, cross country to California or something. I don't know why you don't go to California, but that's okay, it's beautiful. But if you're going to take a trip, probably it would be better to check your vehicle out before you go than after when you get back. Oh, we made that trip, now let me change the oil. You know? All right, makes more sense, right? So if we think about spiritual warfare, it's all the time. There's never a time that the devil and the world is not trying to attack you and pull you off your game as a Christian. We need to bathe ourselves in preparation in spiritual battle, spiritual warfare. So I want to encourage you. Maybe you have a habit of praying at night, and that's fine if that works for you. But if you're trying to start up something, you want to start a new habit, I want to encourage you to check it out before you start your day. If you can wake up a little early, students, I know it's hard. Senior adults, I know it's hard. It's hard for you. Sometimes it's hard to get up early, you know, but set that alarm clock, one snooze more, you know, 9 more minutes or whatever, and say, I'm going to start my day spending it in prayer for my day, for the battle which I'm about to face. I'm about to put my feet on the floor, or maybe you roll out of bed and you pray by the side of your bed for the day that you're about to experience. So if you're trying to start a habit, I want to encourage you, you can pray anytime, but one of the things I want to encourage you to do is pray beforehand. Get your mindset, because we talk about this in our senior Bible study Thursday, the battle of spiritual warfare is fought right here in between your ears. This is in your mind. There are the powers and principalities that we face are all right here. All right, number three on your outline is the perpetualness of prayer. And this is the perpetualness, this is the P I had to kind of make a stretch for. You know, kind of make everything all nice and alliterated. But what I'm talking about here is praying without ceasing. In our prayer life, you know, 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing, or the NIV says pray continually. These are things that we need to learn to be consistent and frequent with. We need to kind of keep the same habits, so to speak. If we want to build habits, you know, when I grew up, I grew up on some reruns of the old Batman show. The one where they did the pow, sonic whack, you know, all that stuff. That was just cool, you know. And at the end of every Batman episode, back then, in black and white, I think it was, it said, see you next time, same bat channel, same, you know, all right. So what they're doing, they're trying to say, hey, don't forget, tune in next week, same time, you know, just like your shows and things you watch today, they try to build some stability there and some continuity in your attention for that, whatever show they're trying to get you to watch on TV. It's the same thing in our prayer life. God wants us to be consistent. He wants us to have the same back prayer time, same back place. You know, so I would encourage you, if you're struggling to be consistent in your prayer life, let me encourage you to try to keep things on a similar time scale. Maybe you pray at the same time every morning or every evening. Maybe you pray at the same place. One thing I've done, I'll get up, go down to the kitchen after I get dressed. I'll have my Bible there, I'll read, and I'll spend some time praying while I'm feeding myself. And that's my time for it. And that's something that I try to do every single day, so it becomes a habit. And if you're struggling with having a habit of prayer, let me encourage you to find something similar every single time so that you can build that. When you've built that up, then you can maybe stretch a little bit, change it up a little bit. I don't know who the experts are, but I've always said, experts say it takes, you know, 21 days to create a habit. If you're doing something, whether it's, I think about Darren running, he, you know, started summer running for 30 days. That's over the 21 days. But to continually do something for day after day after day, you will create that habit. And so when it comes to your prayer life, it's the same thing. And then finally here, number four in your outline is the partners in prayer. This is where I want to kind of challenge you a little bit this morning. There are different people that we can partner with and pray for. If you are married, I think the very best person that you can pray with is your spouse. Pastor Ben was always talking about men. You know, we have men's breakfasts. We need to bring this back. But occasionally. He would say, men, pray with your wives. Pray with your spouse. And I think that's a great thing. You can pray for them. You can pray with them. There's so many different areas. You can see on the outline there on the bottom of the bulletin, I've listed four different areas here. This is where I want to challenge you. You may say, Pastor John, I'm already praying for my spouse. Great. But maybe the Lord is impressing you to add somebody to pray for today. There's a prayer partner, somebody you can pray with. I thought about throwing up on the screen a picture of my crazy prayer partner, Matt. He's a prayer partner I've had now for a little over a year, and he attends 12-stone church with his family. He and I get together once a week, usually on Tuesday or Thursday, and we eat and we pray for each other. We share prayer requests. We hold each other accountable. How are you doing with this? And we pray for each other, and we pray for each other during the week. But over the years, I remember the first time I asked somebody to do a prayer partner with me was probably about 20 years ago. Had a gentleman come and just felt led. Heard people talk about it all the time, but I never did anything with it. And I said, hey, Todd, Pastor was talking about prayer partners. Would you like to do that? And so we started doing that. And over the years, I've had different prayer partners. Sometimes I've gone periods without having a prayer partner because they moved, or they, you know, and it just took some time for me to find somebody. But that kind of comes and goes. Maybe that's something that you have never even considered before. I want to encourage you to think about that. I want to encourage you also to, if you're seeking a prayer partner, find somebody that is, you know, if you're a female, your prayer partner is a female. If you're a guy, find a guy. That's the options there. You know, you can share things from a female or male perspective that they will understand, and you can pray for each other. If the Lord is pushing you today to start praying for that, Lord, send me somebody that can be a prayer partner for me. I'm going to give you a minute here as we close out for you to advertise on the help wanted over here that you would like a prayer partner. I'll give you some instructions in just a minute. Another way that we can pray for each other is what, like it says in James 5:16. It says, you know, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another. We can pray for one another. You may take a mental picture of the people that are here today. And as you go on today, go about your business with your family, whenever you have that prayer time, Lord, you know, hey, Lord, just, I'm just going to use Linda as a guy. I saw Linda there, and she just looked a little stressed out, so I just want to pray for her. And, you know, you'll look stressed out. But take that mental snapshot and remember people that you interacted with for that day. It could have been a server at lunch or dinner or something that, man, they were just having a bad day. And you say, please pray for her. I don't even remember her name, but you know who she is. And pray for one another. And then the last thing I want to encourage you to do is to be a prayer partner in the different missions and ministries that we have at Westside, and also that you know in our community. Westside supports, if you look at our budget, we have different missions and ministries that we support. I talked with Tim Cummings this past week. It's been a couple weeks since I talked to him and went to see how he was doing. He said, they're doing okay. He said, ministry is rough. He said, we're not getting out. He said, that's communication. So I want to just share that with you so that maybe you will pray for Tim Cummings and his ministry there in the International Village area for Clarkston and all the areas that he serves in his apartments. Maybe it's something else that we support that you want to pray for. But, on my prayer list, I kind of kicked myself, man, I didn't put the ministries here, so I added mine, you know, pray for Tim Cummings and his ministry. I added that person for myself, but those are different areas that we can partner with and we can actually practice our prayer with. So wherever you're at today, as we close out here, I want to use this board again, and Floby will be down here in just a minute to help you, because I know it's kind of up. Because I can't do anything straight. I decided to be weird and make it all over in English. But what I want to ask you to do today, if you want to come get a prayer bracelet, you can do one, that's great. But over here are some post-it notes and some pens and markers. What I want to ask you to take time, we're going to pray just a minute and seek the Lord. You don't have to do this today. You may come back next week. You may pray through it this week and come back next week and add to it. Don't do it because I'm asking you to, but I want to ask you to take a post-it note and maybe write on there who you feel the Lord is leading you to pray for. You might just put spouse on there. You might say a friend. You don't have to get specific if you know who that is. Maybe you want to write on there praying for a ministry, Tim Cummings or whatever. And just put that on here. Mr. Floyd will help kind of stick those up there if you know we have some children and different areas, but we're going to put that on there. Now, if you are considering maybe looking for a prayer partner, what I want to ask you to do is put your name on a post-it note, and I want you to just circle it or box it out with the marker as a way of saying, hey, I'm maybe looking for somebody that I could pray with. So this will be kind of like a hook, one type thing, okay? You may go up there and you see, well, I saw Rebecca go up there and put her name up there. She's looking for somebody to pray with, and so am I. So maybe we can pray together. And I understand how that goes. Sometimes finding a prayer partner, you have to, you know, kind of seek that out, say, you know, maybe that's a good fit, maybe it's not. But as you pray that out, but if you feel led to put your name up there, again, just circle it or box it, and that lets people know that, hey, I need somebody to pray with me, whether that prayer is weekly, twice a month, once a month, you know, you can figure out those details as you go. But I want to do something that's practical. If you feel led to step up your prayer game, you know, this is a way you can kind of hold yourself accountable and say, hey, I'm committed to praying for my spouse. I'm committed to pray for a prayer partner. I'm committed to pray for one of the ministries here at Westside or all the things we talked about. So that's what I want to do this morning with the board. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I just pray for our church. I pray for our members. Lord, I pray in just the short amount of time that we're talking about how we can apply prayer to our life. Lord, I pray that you're working. Your Holy Spirit is moving on the hearts and minds of the people that are here, that are listening, for those that are at home. Lord, I will pray that we will be obedient, Lord. Maybe there's somebody that is on our mind right now. Lord, I pray that we would commit to praying for them, that we would commit to developing our own prayer life to be more consistent, that we would commit to making our prayer time, our posture better. We would come to you boldly, Lord, that we know you hear us, God. We know that you will answer us. And we come with an expectation, Lord, that you are going to work and you're going to do something. Whatever you are moving in our midst, Lord, I pray that we will act, that we will respond. Yeah, but Lord, I pray for those that are here this morning that do not have a relationship with you. Maybe they've heard us talking about that, and talking about putting our faith in Jesus, and it's by grace that we are saved. Lord, your word teaches that if we will call upon your name, that you will save us, God. Romans 10:13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Maybe you've been checking out Christianity. Maybe you've been trying to understand who Jesus really is and what he's done for us. Let me tell you, Jesus loves you. He gave himself completely up. He willingly went to the cross for your and my sin, to die for my sin, for your sin, so that we could have a relationship with God. He paid for our sin debt. And if you believe that this morning, you can pray and ask Jesus Christ to come into your life, to be your Lord, to be your Savior, by saying a simple prayer like this, saying, dear God, I know that you love me. I know that you died for my sins. Today, Lord, I want to give you my life the best way I know how. Come into my life. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. Today I turn from my ways of living for myself. I place my faith and trust in you. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer this morning, if you want to come down, I'd just love to shake your hand and pray for you and kind of help you along with your next steps, what you can do as a new believer, someone who just trusted Christ as your Lord, as your Savior. I just want to sit down with you. You don't have to come up here and make a speech or anything. I just want to share a little bit with you. If you'd like to come and join the church today, you can do that. If you want to come and pray and just ask the Lord to help you in your prayer life and say, Lord, help me be a better prayer warrior for my family, for my spouse, for my friends, for my church. And then the table's over here. If you already know what you feel like you're committed to the Lord, you want to pray for somebody, you can come down here and write that name on the board and put that up there. So let's pray, and then we'll let Rebecca take over. Father, Lord, this is your time. Lord, I pray that you would work, that your Holy Spirit is active. Help us now, Lord. We need your help. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Working all the things out. Let me know what we need to
yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Oh, yes, I will.
Can I ask Brother Lyle to come and just pray for an offering? As you know, just put it back there. You can drop that in the offering plate as you leave the sanctuary this morning.
Yes, as you know, normally this time of the service, we have some young men bringing offering plates down here, and because of the coronavirus, we have felt maybe it was safer to do it another way. And God's way off is different than what you expect. Those of you listening on the internet, please look on the net for a way to make your donation via internet or by mail. Or better yet, next Sunday, bring it with you.
Amen.
That's right.
But however you do it, there is a place in the back of the church for that you make that donation. Father, we do thank you for the word that has been presented to us today.
Amen.
We thank you for the talent of those who have offered up praises to your name, for you are worthy of all praises.
Amen.
And Father, we bring to you just a small portion of that which you blessed us with. We ask you, Lord, to use that to increase and glorify your kingdom, that the name of Christ may be known throughout the world, that more people on a daily basis will come to depend on him. It's in his name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Just to announce, too, we're having our Justice Bible study tonight at 6 p.m. We'll live stream that, so if you're not able to come, you can watch that. But you'll miss out singing some of the hymns if you don't come tonight. We'll do that tonight at 6 p.m. We'll be in Genesis 18 looking at Abraham and his three visitors. So, hope you have a great afternoon. We'll see you later this week.
I was not prepared to play that long. I was like,
Mama, how do you feel about Red Lobster?